Welcome everyone to the 28th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I've received no apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 5 and 6 in private today, as well as to take certain items in private as required at our next meeting on the 25th of October. We agreed? We've agreed. The next item on our agenda today is consideration of a notification from Scottish Ministers for consent to the following instruments, the Food and Feed Miscellaneous Amendments Regulations 2022, and this notification concerns provisions made to amend retained direct European Union law in various areas of food and feed law, including legislation on novel foods, food additives, enzymes and flavourings, genetically modified food and feed, feed additives, food contact materials and the hygiene of foodstuffs. Now, under the protocol between the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government, this consent notification has been categorised as Type 1, meaning that the Scottish Parliament's agreement is sought before the Scottish Government gives consent to the UK Government making secondary legislation in devolved competence. Now, before I ask members for their views on this instrument, I just want to point out how little time or no time we've been given for scrutiny of this. This was laid very late to the Scottish Government. The Scottish Government have written to us with a recommendation that, you know, we consent and they have no issues with it. However, there's still some outstanding issues. Now, we as a Parliament, our consent is asked for, and our committee consent is asked for in situations like this. But to not have had any notice of this, not allowed any time for scrutiny of it, like we could have had a minister in front of us today, but we're not able to do that. And also, we have some, we've flagged up that there's actually an outstanding consultation on this that's not due to report until today. So there may be recommendations or issues that are thrown up by this consultation that we don't have sight of. Now, we do not want to hold up anything that's fixing some of the issues that are with regard to everything that I've just mentioned, this instrument. But I have to put on record my severe dissatisfaction at this situation that we find ourselves in. I don't know if any other colleagues have any comments on this. Evelyn.
Yeah, convener, I agree entirely that we have not had sufficient time to scrutinise, and given the information that we now know about the consultation that's outstanding, that makes the matter even worse, really. The Minister even says in her own letter to the committee that she can't share the draft SI. It's not in the public domain yet. So it all seems very, very rushed. And I really think the committee has been put in a very, very difficult position.
Thank you. Emma, did I see your hand?
Yep, thanks, convener. I agree with you and I agree with Evelyn. I mean, I know that paragraph 4 says that this is issues of fixing deficiencies, inoperabilities, inconsistencies. You know, just reading through it, I have so many things labelled on it. I know there are policy issues, there are technical issues. I understand that consent is being sought, but, you know, there's issues around just reading what we've received about the do not eat pictogram and how that will work going forward, because there were issues that haven't been resolved in the labelling of products. So yeah, I'm concerned about the fact that we have not had enough time to scrutinise this statutory instrument.
Okay, I have a suggestion, and given the pressing nature we've all got in front of us, and I'll ask members for their views on whether we consent or not. But regardless of that, I'm suggesting that the committee writes a letter to the UK government department that has issued this. Now, we need to recognise that maybe part of the reason is the death of the Queen, but we do believe that this was up against the wire even before that. So, you know, the point has to be made that we exist for a reason, and that is to scrutinise what we're agreeing to. And if we don't have time to do that, then it's just a tick box exercise, and I just don't think we should be in that position. We also write to the Scottish Government as well, which will obviously regarding our decision today, but also making that point to them as well, Gillian.
Thanks, Convener. In that letter, could we also ask for an update on the outstanding consultation that's coming forward, and on the point you made about the fact that we probably should have seen this earlier? That's even more concerning, given the closing date of the consultation that we've been advised of. It would mean that when we were considering this SI, there could have been several weeks where a consultation was still live and we were being asked to consider this.
Yeah. Okay, we will do that. Right, so I'm going to ask members, is the committee content that the provisions set out in the notification should be included in the proposed UK SI? So we're in agreement, notwithstanding the comments that have been made. And finally, is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off on that, the letters that we've mentioned, both to the Scottish Government informing of our decision today and an additional letter to the UK Government regarding the timescale and the lack of scrutiny opportunity? Yes. Okay, we're in agreement. Thank you very much, members. Right, we move on to our first substantive item of today's agenda, which is the independent review into racism in Scottish cricket. We'll just wait for our panel to take their seats. So I welcome to the committee Gordon Arthur, the Interim Chief Executive of Cricket Scotland, and Forbes Dunlop, the Chief Operating Officer of Sports Scotland. We have got an hour for questions, and we have a lot of questions. Off the back of the report, which I have here, changing the boundaries and issues that they have highlighted, issues that have been highlighted by a number of very brave individuals who've come forward, who anyone watching this will have seen. And I would like to ask, off the back of this report and the recommendations here, often when things like this come out into the public domain, when they hit the headlines, there'll be a number of people who will feel that they want to come forward. Now, obviously, there was a great deal of work in engaging with people who had issues as part of the report. And what I would like to ask you, Gordon Arthur, have there been, since the report has been published, have more people come forward? And anybody involved in cricket in Scotland right now, what would you say to them if they haven't come forward yet, but they want to raise issues, and given them the confidence and the courage to do so, that their concerns will be taken seriously and that they won't be subjected to some of the terrible things that we've heard that the people who came forward before were subjected to? Mr. Arthur.
Thank you. The Plan for Sport helpline has been kept open. Sport Scotland have kept it open since the report was published on the 25th of July. I believe further referrals have come forward in that time. I couldn't tell you how many, but I believe further referrals have come forward. We've been concentrating on the 68 that were passed over at that point. I do believe there are more that have come forward since then. And as I said on the day of the publication, it's, you know, the publication of this report was a very dark day for cricket in Scotland. The report laid bare a picture which is appalling. You cannot justify and justify the scale of this and brush it off as being just a reflection of things that have go on in society more generally. But we are looking at a societal problem through the lens of cricket. We can't solve it on our own, but we are determined that we are going to solve it and make cricket a welcoming place for everybody in the sport. And if there are people out there who still have evidence that they want to give and who feel they've been treated badly in the past, then I would urge them to come forward. The more we understand the scale and depth of the problem, the better we'll be placed to deal with it.
Mm-hmm. The action plan was 30th of September was the date that the action plan was meant to come forward. Now, I think that one of the very strongest and most upsetting aspects of what was reported was that when people did come forward before, many years ago, that they were either ignored or there were no structures in place in order to support them. Can you outline what the action plan is going to do to make sure that when people do come forward, that they are dealt with in a way that is supportive and actually investigates their claims and does not lead to any kind of adverse effects on the individuals that are brave enough to do so?
Yeah, well, we have a process which has been put in place over the summer to ensure that all the referrals that came in prior to the publication of the report and since will be dealt with through an independent process. We've partnered with Sporting Equals to help run that process for us to make sure that we have a very thorough process that everybody feels confident in. The action plan has got a small number of main strands to it. One of those strands is to put in place an anti-racism and ED&I strategy. And that strategy itself has to deal with a range of issues, of which this is one. So we need to put in place a method of collecting data so that we are clear of the people playing cricket in Scotland, what their backgrounds are, where they're from, and a whole range of different data pieces that will enable us to track how our work's going in the years ahead. We need to put in place a survey to update that annually. We need to put in place education and training for the workforce in cricket in Scotland to make sure that everybody understands what needs to be done going forward. And we need to build a long-term and robust process to do exactly what you're asking, to make sure that the process we have in place at the moment to deal with this temporarily is built into a long-term process to make sure that that people feel they can come forward, and when they do come forward, that they will be listened to and they can trust the process will speak to them, listen to them thoroughly and deal with their complaints appropriately.
Thank you. I've got a question for Mr. Dunlop about the wider implications for sport in Scotland. And obviously this report has come out off the back, as I said, of whistleblowers, of many complaints over many years that haven't been dealt with appropriately, and it's come to a head. Now, it shouldn't have to be the bravery of individuals. I want to know what your reflections are and what your potential actions are with regards to other sports in Scotland. And as Cricket Scotland is in the spotlight, rightly so, but these issues might be across sport in Scotland. What's Sport Scotland doing?
We've taken a number of steps prior to the cricket review, and the publication of that report had started a couple of years back. We did a piece of work with the other home country sports councils in UK sport to look at race and racism and inequalities, and so there was an action plan developed on the back of that piece of work. Now we have the cricket report and our learnings and the experiences that's highlighted. We immediately met with all other funded sports to talk to them about the report. They've had a period of time to read, understand, digest, reflect on that report, and we're working with them on an individual basis to understand where they are as a sport, what diversity looks like for their sport, how their complaints processes, appeals processes are placed, the level of independence and scrutiny that's applied to those when they do come into the sport, and I think importantly as well, the culture within this sport, so that when something does happen, how's that managed and dealt with? So we have a range of actions, some, as I say, that were put in place pre the cricket report and this piece of work, but we've built on those now, we've added to those. They all culminate under our EDI strategy, which we developed a couple of years ago now. And again, there's a host of work that we've been doing over a long period of time. But in the last 2 years, a specific focus on race and ethnicity within that EDI action plan that we now have.
Thank you. We move on to my colleagues. Tess White, you have some questions.
Thank you, Convener. A question for Mr Dunlop, please. So Sport Scotland was proactive in commissioning the independent review into racism in cricket earlier this year. However, it was after allegations emerged in the public. So my question, Mr Dunlop, is what oversight and involvement did Sport Scotland have before? Thank you.
We have a range of tools, interventions with all funded bodies that we're involved in, including some independent audits of those organisations. And so we did have, and we had been working with Cricket Scotland. We clearly didn't know the depth of what was happening within the sport or the failings within the sport, but we were working with Cricket Scotland on an EDI action plan at that point. We were using some expert resource to work with them, and plans had been developing and evolving. Quite rightly, they were shelved once we started to realise the size and scale of the issue at hand here, and we've had to reflect on our own processes, our own audits, so that we get underneath these types of issues much earlier than we did in cricket. So there is a period of reflection, some consideration of what we do and how we do it, and there are changes that we will be making.
So you knew, but you just didn't know the size and scale.
We knew there were some challenges, but absolutely, we didn't know that anywhere near the size and scale and over the period of time that has now been published in the report.
Thank you. Emma.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to you both. I've got a question for Gordon Arthur. It's about the change in the boundaries review that had recommendations to produce the action plan that the Convener has mentioned by September 30. And I understand the action plan, it hasn't been published yet and it's delayed, and that's because there hasn't been adequate or perhaps no anti-racist expertise utilised to scrutinise the plan prior to publication. So I'm interested in your comments about, I guess, the delay in the plan and what action has been taken to embed anti-racist expertise in the plan, and then when do we think the action plan will be published?
Thank you. The action plan is out for consultation with Running Out Racism just now. It has been it was first developed in the middle of August and has been a developing plan since then. We have been reporting to Running Out Racism on some progress against the plan, but I don't believe they had seen the plan until the end of last week, the actual plan itself. But the plan takes the recommendations from the Change in the Boundaries report and puts it into a plan. That we haven't changed those recommendations at all. They're exactly the same recommendations as the plan set out, the things that Cricket Scotland needed to address, and indeed Sport Scotland needed to address. They've been put into a document, and I think the work really falls into three main areas. We need to put in place the review process for the referrals and start that. And that process started about two weeks ago, I think. We need to hold a governance review, which we've now agreed the terms and costing of that. And that governance review is about to kick off. That will be finished by the end of the year. And we need to put in place an ED&I, an anti-racism advisory group, to run all of that work. And we've been recruiting people to go on to that. A member of the Running Out Racism campaign will be part of that advisory group. And so all the work that's done looking at the ED&I strategy and everything that falls out of that will be done with the involvement of Running Out Racism and a number of other people from the universities and other sectors who've got a huge amount of ED&I knowledge and experience. So all of that work, we hope, will have the full involvement of people with lived experience and other relevant experience from different organisations to help us drive that work forward.
Okay, just a final wee question. The report was published in July 2022 and then the action plan was going to be end of September. Has it just grown arms and legs and got bigger as you've uncovered issues that need to be dealt with, so that you've had to, I suppose, not prolong the publishing, but just make a more in-depth approach to tackling racism in Scottish cricket?
Well, the tasks which need to be done are the same tasks that were in the original report. What we've really spent most of the last 2 months doing since the report was published is putting in the groundwork, building the foundations for the real work to start. So that's been recruiting the new board. It's been recruiting people to go on to the advisory group to run all the ED&I work and to get agreement as to how the governance review is going to be done. So the last 2 months have really been all about putting in those building blocks for the work to happen now. So understanding what was involved as part of that has come since the report was published, because we didn't see the report before it was published. And we've been working, you know, as hard and fast as we can over that period of time, engaging as best we can over that period of time to get us to a point where everybody's happy, that we're aligned and have got shared goals with the same long-term vision, and that's where we want to be. And so it takes a lot of time just going through that process. But you know, I think the action plan, I hope, will be out and published this week.
Okay, thank you.
Just off the back of it, just listening to you and going back to my earlier question about referrals and people who've come forward. Obviously, people have come forward during the writing of the report, and people have come forward since. Is it fair to say that they have not been investigated yet? That process is not underway yet? That seems to be what I'm getting from you. That, I mean, you're talking about all the important actions that need to take place structurally, the high level kind of policy and putting all the governance in place, but the actual nuts and bolts of actually investigating all the allegations that people have come forward to make, where are we with that? What communication is being made with the people who've come forward to let them know the process that they're going to be involved in?
So the over the summer, the putting in place this independent process to review the referrals took us through until the 13th of September. So on that day, we announced what the process was going to be, gave more information on what the process would be, and we also said at that time that the first individual investigations had begun that week. So two things were happening at that stage. The front end of the process is a kind of triaging process to try and see from within the 68 referrals which are the most important, which are the most urgent, which are the most serious, and to try and prioritise that work. And then once that triaging process is finished, which should be finished in, I think, a week or two's time, then we'll have a complete plan for, you know, the order which things will look at. But the first two or three cases have already started being investigated.
And the communication aspect of my question there, how has that been communicated to everybody that's come forward? Are they all being communicated to individually to let them know that, you know, their reports have been received and this process is what to expect?
I'll need to check, but I think a letter went out to all of them on the 13th of September or the day before. I'll need to check that.
Okay.
But I'm pretty sure that happened.
Okay. I'm going to hand over to Sandesh Gulhani. Sandesh, who's joining us online.
Thank you, Convener. I've been listening with interest, and Convener, I'm really quite angry and upset. The publication of this report is not a dark day for Scotland. What happened was a dark day for Scotland. The idea of trying to hide behind societal issues is not good enough. I just have a feeling that this is not being taken seriously enough and things are not going forward at the pace we wanted to. So my first question for Gordon Arthur is, where is the HR officer and why has one not been appointed?
There are four roles that that were recommended that we appoint in the Changing the Boundaries report. One of those, the HR manager, is a role that we are not sure that the organisation would ideally have in the long run. We are a very small organisation. The staff, including the contracted cricket players, including the development team and the team who run fixtures, for example, when we have international fixtures on, if you take those out, you're left with a staff of about half a dozen people in Cricket Scotland, including myself, the finance, head of finance, an administrative assistant, and for Cricket Scotland to employ a full-time HR manager in that in an organisation of that size doesn't necessarily look to be the right way to go forward. We have other ways of accessing HR support, so we are getting a lot of support from Sport Scotland on HR-related managers. Their ED&I officer is helping us with all of our documentation, our job adverts, our job descriptions, are all being supported by Sport Scotland. The recruitment processes we've been running over the last few months are all being helped by Sport Scotland, using the same HR resources they have and ED&I specialist resources they have. One of the things we're doing internally at the moment is reviewing our entire staffing structure to try and make sure that the organisation, which is several members of staff short where it needs to be a properly functioning organisation, has got the resources in place to be able to be a first-class governing body for sport, which when I arrived there in July, it clearly wasn't. So we haven't started the process for the recruiting an HR manager at this stage because we're getting very good support from Sport Scotland in all the HR-related matters we need. We will review all those four posts as we go forward. And depending on what comes out of the governance review and the ED&I strategy, we will then be able to develop a job description which reflects the work that's going to be done for recruiting things like our own ED&I resource full-time later on.
Thank you for the answer. I do feel that, you know, on one hand you're saying you don't need a full-time HR because there are only six of you, and then you're talking about a full-scale review of all the people and all the things that you need to do. That doesn't really seem to balance. But what work is going into place now to ensure that there is greater diversity within not just Cricket Scotland, but also the volunteers that you've got and the encouragement to get players playing at the top level to make Scotland successful?
Well, all of that work will come out of the ED&I strategy. That's why we've put in place the advisory group to help us with a lot of external expertise. We are already working very closely with Sport Scotland. For example, all of our job adverts that go out are being put out through networks to try and make sure that people, for example, in the South Asian communities are aware of the opportunities. We would love to have more women involved in the administration of the sport. So again, we've been putting out our job adverts to various organisations to try and promote better diversity amongst our staffing across cricket in Scotland. We have a huge amount of success at a club level in Scotland for attracting people from very diverse communities. There are many examples of clubs right over the country where in excess of 75% of the members of those clubs are from South Asian communities. In some of the junior clubs, the numbers way up into the 90s. So at club level, there are huge numbers of young people from very diverse backgrounds playing the sport. People ask the question, why does that not reflect itself all the way through the age group levels and the national sport, the national teams? And that is work that we're going to be doing in the coming months. Paul Reddish from Running Out Racism is hopefully going to do a piece of work with us to look at the equality throughout the entire journey from people coming into the sport right the way up to international level, looking at all the barriers that may exist in that journey and trying to make sure that we have a process and a pathway that allows youngsters to come all the way through right up to the national team with an equal opportunity to others. So there's a lot of work going to be done to address those points. None of those bits of work are quick fixes. They're all requiring a very, very substantial change to the way the sport's been organised in the past. But I do believe they will make a huge difference to the way the sport is in the years ahead.
Thank you. Sandesh, am I able to move on, or have you got anything else you want to ask? Yeah. Can I come to questions from Paul O'Kane? Paul.
Thank you, convener, and good morning. I wonder if I can just pick up perhaps where we left the last question there around that grassroots issue and the fact that young players from a South East Asian background in particular don't progress to the national level, and that there is a real feeling from the survey respondents about the challenges that exist. I mean, 54% of people from a non-white background who responded to the survey said that they wouldn't agree with the statement that there's a kind of a level playing field or a fair opportunity of access to that national level. So I appreciate what you said, Gordon, about the review that's ongoing. But, you know, I represent a community where there are so many young people from a Southeast Asian background who are playing cricket, who are enthusiastic about cricket, who are well supported by their families, who are passionate. And they don't seem to think that there's a prospect that they're going to be able to progress. So what's your assessment of why that is?
I've been in cricket in Scotland since the 18th of July, so I haven't been involved personally to have a long perspective in that. I've been told many of the facts that you're quoting me. I've heard a lot of anecdotal stories. I've heard stories from people who feel they've not been given a fair opportunity at the juncture from 17s to the 19s or 19s to full squad. There's a perception that people are not being given a fair opportunity to progress, and I see it as my job to get behind that perception, to test it out, to find out what the reasons are why people aren't coming through the process, and to try and create a process that ensures that everybody who wants to gets a fair opportunity to get all the way through up to the international team. I can't imagine why anybody would want our international team not to turn out its 11 best players every time it plays. The idea of excluding people because of their skin colour or because they live in a more remote part of the country and can't compete because they can't get to a big club that plays in the top leagues. You know, any reasons why people would be excluded need to be explored. And as I say, we need to build a process that gives people as much opportunity as possible.
I mean, you said people's perception. I'm not sure it is a perception. I think there's a real challenge and a real demonstrable challenge for people in terms of being able to access. As I said, I represent and come from East Renfrewshire, a community where we have a large Southeast Asian community, where people, as I say, are well supported. There are a number of clubs, there are a number of school opportunities, for example. I would really like to hear a commitment from you that you're going to go to these communities and speak to people, particularly young people, who have had really challenging experiences, and get a sense from them, not perhaps of what we would perceive the situation to be, but perhaps what the reality of the situation is. So are you going to give that undertaking? I appreciate what you said about commissioning work to be done, but I think you in this role and whoever continues the leadership of this organisation to come to these communities.
We need to talk to as many people as possible. What we need to do is make sure that we have a really broad understanding of the grassroots sport, and in talking to members in different communities and different clubs, that's one of the best ways we can do that. So I'm happy to say that when that work's ongoing, that we will be out there talking to to everybody in the sport to try and understand. I've also talked to people from Southeast Asian communities who've described to me why they stopped playing the game at age 19, who had had a very good experience through the 15s, the 17s, the 19s, and they were under huge amounts of pressure from within their family to get professional qualifications, to go to university, to become doctors or lawyers and what have you, and stop playing the sport because they're at that stage in their life, their focus shifted away from trying to be an international sports person to becoming a professional person with a career and continuing to play sport at a club level. You know, there will be many reasons why people don't progress from the junior ranks into the senior ranks, regardless of their skin colour. But we need to understand what all those different reasons are. And I've said it twice, I'll say it a third time, we need to have a really thorough look at the whole journey and make sure that the barriers, if there are barriers there, are removed so that everybody gets a fair opportunity to progress through the system.
If I can, Convener, I think what's clear is we need to drill down, and I think it's my previous point about speaking to those communities, and I think that that's absolutely vital. I wonder if I can just move this on slightly, because I'm conscious of time. I wonder if there's a challenge for many people in terms of professional players setting an example and the players that they play alongside not understanding some of these really systemic issues, and I suppose the kind of the deep-rooted nature of racism and that sort of the challenges that exist around that, and perhaps not being aware very often of the challenges that people face. To what extent has there been training for other professional players on racism, on how they conduct themselves on social media and in various other spaces? Does that exist currently?
Yes, it does, and the men's international team, and I believe the women's international team have all had ED&I training, and that needs to be an ongoing part of how we support the squads to make sure that they do fully appreciate all the issues and that the understanding of those issues is as thorough as it can be.
Thank you, Paul. Can I bring in Tess White?
Yes, Convener. Can I just go back before I ask a question on this? Earlier you said that you wanted to involve more women in administration. Could you clarify what that means, please?
Just in the running of the sport. The Cricket Scotland board, until fairly recently, I don't think had women representatives on it. The volunteer base within the sport is largely white middle-aged males who are running the sport and on a practical level day to day. The women's game is growing, and it would be great if we had more representatives from women's cricket involved in running all of cricket.
Thank you. So governance is your definition of administration. Thank you. My question is, in terms of the work that you're undertaking to improve transparency in player selection, could you share with us what that is, please?
Yeah, well, I mean, one of the things that that became obvious to me fairly early on is that Cricket Scotland has not been an organisation that's been particularly transparent about many things. It's just got on and done things, hasn't explained to people how they've been done, hasn't published processes for people to see how decisions are made. And that, feeds discontent when decisions are unpopular with people. If you can't go back and see who was involved, why were they involved, what the process was, so that the questions asked earlier about international selection are a very clear case in point of that, is that historically selection meetings have taken place, teams have been picked, and squads have been announced. but there's been no information behind that at all. So for the Men's World Cup squad, the men are out in Australia now preparing for the T20 World Cup. We put a lot of work into trying to put together a very clear and describe and write down and publish a very clear process as to how the squad was picked, who was involved in picking the squad, why were they involved in picking the squad, in talking to people as to who should chair the selection committee, because we had a new chair of the selection committee. We had a number of people advising, but not voting on the selections, so that we had a much broader, diverse inputs into the meeting than has happened in the past. And that's a step towards having a permanent published selection process for the international teams. And my view is we need to take that down to the under-19s, the under-17s, the under-15s, where I think things are probably even less clear than at the top international team level. The top international squads have always had, there's always been a chair of selectors, and there's always been the head coach and the two assistant coaches or what have you have made those decisions. When you get further down through the age groups, it tends just to be the coach of that squad on their own making those decisions. And if, you know, if that is the case, then in my view, that's not transparent enough, and we shouldn't be relying on one person to do that. And we're unlikely to improve diversity unless we have particularly focused individuals who are trying to, you know, make sure that diversity comes all the way through those age group teams. So listen, there's a huge amount of work to be done in transparency in the organisation that I'm now running. A huge amount of transparency that we need to bring into all of our work, and I'm completely committed to making sure that happens. And I think the process for the selection of the men's international team was appreciated that we have done what we've done. And I think that's an important stepping stone to better transparency in all of that area in the coming years.
Thank you. Evelyn Sweet, you have some questions.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you both. What is Sport Scotland doing to support Cricket Scotland generally and in its record-keeping, reporting procedures and complaints processes?
Sure. I think since the publication of this report, we have been working very, very closely with Gordon in particular and his small team, and he's outlined a number of the practical expertise that we have and that we can provide to cricket. So over the last 2 months, we are essentially on a day-to-day basis helping Gordon run Cricket Scotland. We are trying to be really clear in terms of jurisdiction, so that we don't make procedural mistakes in some of the changes that we are making, because it's really important that cricket is reviewed and set up and structured in a way which is robust and transparent for the future. So we're working closely with Cricket Scotland to put in place those changes, to provide the expertise and the support that cricket don't have in this first phase, and also importantly to hold cricket to account for the changes that need to happen. We meet with a group, Cricket Scotland, Sport Scotland and representatives from Running Out Racism. We've got a monthly meeting now established, so that there's check and challenge both from Sport Scotland, but also an opportunity for Running Out Racism to raise concerns or questions that they have about the progress that's been made and the steps that are being taken. In terms of the monitoring of that, it's done through those groups and those meetings. Gordon's touched on a number of times. We felt it was very important to get in place the big building blocks first, so making sure that the governance review is, the terms for that are set and established properly, that the referrals are rightly prioritised given the nature of those referrals and the individuals involved, and that the board is recruited and appointed so that Cricket Scotland is in a place to make changes to its governance, to make decisions and to move forward as an organisation. So we've been working with Cricket Scotland on a daily basis to make sure they have the expertise and that we prioritise the right things in the right order to get the big building blocks in place so that we can then address lots of the points that the committee have made this morning.
In Sport Scotland's statement of the 30th September, it was noted that robust actions and genuine cultural change were needed within the sport. Can you offer us assurances today that that is what we are going to get? Because given the progress to date, we don't see that at the present time. Can you give us assurances that there is going to be real change and real cultural change within Scottish cricket?
Yeah, absolutely. And when I talk about the foundations that we're putting in place, one of the most fundamental things is that the leadership through the board of Cricket Scotland understands the need for cultural change. So through the recruitment process for the chair and for the board members, that's absolutely embedded into the process. And so, yeah, of course, that's our absolute commitment, that cultural change needs to happen, and it needs to happen in a structured way. We believe that happens from the board, the governance review, the EDI working group that Gordon's talked that he's setting up and putting in place, the types of people that are being invited onto that group, the background, the expertise that they bring to that, all are all set up to deliver the cultural change that we all need to see.
Thank you, Evelyn. Tess, you have some more questions around funding.
Yes. So it's clear that whole scale change is needed at Cricket Scotland. But what funding is in place to support that change?
I mean, Sport Scotland have invested in Cricket Scotland for a period of time, and again, as we work through these steps and we understand what the organisation needs to look like, there are opportunities to invest and support the organisation either directly or indirectly, as we're doing just now, through either our own expertise that we have within Sport Scotland or expert resource that we can buy in, contract in on behalf of Cricket Scotland. So there are resources available to support Cricket Scotland. In the first instance, I think indirectly is the best way to do that, because we still aren't clear what the structure of the organisation needs to look like, and it would be right to give the new board time to come in to fully understand this and for them to have a say in that. But short term, as I say, indirectly, longer term, there are resources if we feel it's the right thing to do and it would benefit the game of cricket in Scotland.
Thank you. So you're saying that nothing has been ring-fenced and nothing has been set aside yet?
No.
That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I come to Gillian Mackay? Gillian.
Thanks, Convener. Has Cricket Scotland established a formalised method of communication for sharing updates and examples of good practice between itself, regional associations and clubs?
At this point in time, not yet. The relationship between Cricket Scotland and the regions, and the relationship between the regions and the clubs and Cricket Scotland, I don't think is particularly fit for purpose as it is at the moment. It's bound up in the history of the way the sport's been governed. But I hope and expect that the government's review will dramatically change that, so that we have better processes in place and more resources in place to manage certain really big and important things more centrally. And one of those would be around conduct and discipline, which has obviously been a big focus of this report. I don't think the processes and the application of those processes we've had in place has always been consistent. We need to have, on lots of areas like that, as well as on safeguarding and child safety and health and safety, we need to have a more consistent approach across the whole sport. And that is going to require some reset of the relationship between Cricket Scotland and the regions. The reason that we have set a very challenging task for this governance review to be completed by the end of the year is because I would like to be able to implement the outcomes of governance review before the start of next cricket season. Mm-hmm. That's going to require quite possibly changes in articles of association of Cricket Scotland, maybe of the regions. The regions are all structured themselves quite differently, so the implementation of those recommendations, whatever they are that come out of the review, I think will take a little bit of time, and we're only giving ourselves 3 months for that, which I think in itself is going to be a stretch. But if the things we can't do by the start of next season, we'll probably end up having to wait until the start of the following season, and that doesn't make me happy about anything that's important. We've got to get done and in place before the start of the 2023 cricket season. So I think we need to reset the relationship in some areas quite significantly. I think from my early conversations with people in the different regions, that will be welcomed. I'm meeting with the new chair of West District, because you may be aware that the entire West District committees resigned and they had elections in early September. So the new chair of West District I'm meeting with on Friday, you know, that's going to be a crucial relationship between Cricket Scotland and West District, bearing in mind the volume of issues that came out of changing the boundaries that related to West District, and the fact that they were also singled out as being an area that needed, you know, a lot of attention. So I think there's quite an important and significant cultural reset between Cricket Scotland and the regions and the clubs that needs to happen this winter.
Given how important communicating a lot of the work that is going on at a national level to the clubs and the regional associations is, what time frame do you expect to be able to formalise some of that new way of communicating with the regions and the clubs in particular?
Well, I'd love to have it in place already. In our very small staff in Cricket Scotland, we don't currently have a communications person. We haven't had a proper communications person, I believe, since the early part of this year, when the person who left was not replaced. We've just been through a recruitment process to try and bring in a new head of communications, and we had one very, very good candidate come out of that process. Sadly, they've been persuaded by their employer to stay where they are, so we're going to need to restart that recruitment. My background's communication, largely, so I completely understand the need for us to over-communicate at this point in time. The reality is, since I came into this job, I've been working 6 or 7 days a week, 10, 12, 14-hour days. There's only so much we can, you know, we can do in the very short term. We need to get more staff into the organisation, and that comes back to the point about Sport Scotland helping us and the need to identify the structure and the roles and to then get those roles in place. And we also are working in a recruitment environment where prospective candidates are worried about coming and working in Cricket Scotland right now because of everything they've read and seen. So that I have spent days and days and days of my time talking to potential candidates, talking to them about what we're doing and what our ambitions are and what our commitments are, to try and ensure that they understand that the sport is going to change, it's going to change for the better, and it's going to change in a very significant way, to give them confidence that they're coming into an environment that that they, you know, they want to be part of. And it's not easy, but we've just got to keep, you know, pressing on as hard as we can, and formalising communications with the regions, with the clubs, with all participants in the sport, you know, is really important. I hope we'll make progress with that in the coming weeks. But I would love to have a new head of communications in place to, you know, to drive all of that work. Sadly, we're not quite at that point yet.
Do you have time for one more, convener? Thank you. This is more for Mr Dunlop, I think. In the debate we had on this earlier this session brought forward by CoCab Stewart, it was widely recognised that the issues raised within cricket are potentially not unique to cricket. It's obviously important that we take this opportunity to look to the future and help ensure such situations do not happen again anywhere in sport, and that providing an opportunity, and in that providing an opportunity for good practice sharing. Would you consider that at an appropriate time a representative working group be formed to look at the findings of the independent report and to prioritise actions that can be taken to help all governing bodies of sport to be fully inclusive? This could include governing bodies themselves and a representative body in the form of the Scottish Sports Association, ensuring that sports are involved in all discussions and that resulting actions and developments are done with sports and not just to sports. Sports Scotland consider doing that?
Absolutely, and those types of conversations are very live just now. So again, a lot of work done pre the cricket report about this type of work and the support and the expertise and how we get the right level of support and expertise to help sports with sports, and how we also balance that out with when things don't go right and people don't make good decisions and cultures go wrong, how we intervene. So those conversations are live. We're working with a range of partners, including governing body representatives, to make sure that we take all the learnings from the report, we take the work we were doing pre this report, and it comes together in the right balance and package of support and help for sports, but also intervention when sports aren't getting it right.
Can I bring in Paul Kane as a specific question on the regional aspect and the regional associations, Paul?
Thank you, Convener. As someone who represents West Scotland and indeed referred to my previous remarks about the community I come from, I'm just keen to understand what the particular issue is in West. So obviously you heard the comments about the resignation of the board and the replacement, but it seems to me there is a particular challenge in that part of the country. And I don't know if Gordon or Forbes want to elaborate on that.
I'm not sure that I can elaborate more than the Changing the Boundaries report has reported. West District were one of the referrals themselves. They were singled out in that process. We need to understand through the governance review where the discipline process hasn't been working effectively. And we need to make sure that the processes that are put in place work effectively everywhere. I'm not sure that I can add an awful lot more to that which is in the Changing the Boundaries report about the proportion of issues raised that came out of West District. I don't know if you've got anything else, Forbes.
No, I think that's essentially it. So a number of the referrals relate to the West District and the West District's handling of discipline at a district level. And so the Plan for Sport team said that needs to be specifically looked at, and that's a piece of work which is ongoing.
Right, so there's a new board appointed in the West.
West District, yes.
And do you feel confident that they look set to do a complete culture change in that regard?
And Gordon mentioned he's meeting the new chair on Friday. I've not met the new committee of the West District yet. They're certainly a more diverse committee than they previously were. And I know that the special general meeting they held attracted a much wider group of member clubs who have taken great interest in the running of cricket in their district going forward. So it's very early days, but of course that's what we're hoping for.
Yeah. I asked the question the day I was on the special general meeting was done over video link, and I was on the link. There were obviously a lot of new people coming forward, and certainly the next day when I asked one or two people what their feelings were about the new committee in place, Running Out Racism and others felt positive about the changes in personnel involved in WDCU. So that to me is an encouraging start.
Thank you. I'm going to come back to Sandesh and then Stephanie afterwards. Sandesh.
Thank you, Convener. So, listening to what's being said, am I essentially right in saying that there have not been any changes? Everything that you're doing, you're looking to do, you're thinking of doing something, this is sort of where you want to go, but you've got a governance review and an EDI strategy. But right now, from the evidence that I've heard, we don't really have processes and structures in place.
Gordon.
Processes and structures in place for...
Processes and structures in place for... So we heard from Gillian asking for timescales. We've all heard about Paul, about going in to speak to communities. And so we're looking at structures and processes in place to try to increase diversity. We're looking at structures and processes in place on your appointments. We're looking at how... just all the things that have come out and all the issues that we're having, I'm not getting a sense that this is what you've done already and that's what's happened. I'm just getting a sense that this is what you're looking to do.
So thank you for that clarity. So, for example, on our recruitment, on the all the recruitment processes that have been run in the last 2 months, the process has changed. We've had input from an ED&I perspective on job descriptions, on job adverts. We've sent it out to community groups that haven't received these opportunities before to try and encourage and broaden the diversity within the population of people who come forward. We've done the complete reset of the selection process. And the communicating around the changes in the selection process. So where there have been things going on, we have been making changes. But the really big changes that are going to change the long-term culture in the sport will come out of these pieces of work, which are being done in the next 2 or 3 months. But where there are things we've been able to do in the short term, we've been taking those opportunities to improve transparency and to try and improve opportunities as well.
Can I bring in Stephanie Callaghan?
Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks for coming along this morning. Certainly, it seems that these are extremely challenging times, Gordon, not just for cricket, but you've got a lot on your plate too there. And I'm noting as well, Forbes, that you're talking about giving the right level of support and expertise too, and I don't know if there's anything additional, any additional support that could be brought in there. But moving on to developing communication strategies, I'm wondering if there's specific examples from other sports, Forbes, of good practice that could be perhaps adapted and applied to cricket as well.
Yes, yeah, certainly we do have good practice both within Scotland, but also one of the, we talked about this in our update last week, one of the new partnerships that we've been developing over the last 6 months actually is with an organisation called Sporting Equals. Sporting Equals are a UK-based organisation and have done a lot of work with English and UK governing bodies. And again, one of the reasons for developing that partnership, which was pre-cricket, was to bring in a range of expertise that Sporting Equals have that we felt as though we didn't have in Sport Scotland. And so the combination of the expertise there, and we have lots of communications experts, so there's definitely some good practice and there's some learning that we are working with Gordon and his team to make sure that's in place.
That's great. It's certainly different sports, not reinventing the wheel, is certainly a good idea. I'm just wondering as well, lots of the local clubs and regions have actually got really strong links into their community. There's some really, really good work going on there, and I'm wondering if you're thinking about ways that you can actually tap into that and involve perhaps some of those people more as you're going forward. So probably get me a question for yourself, Gordon.
I have already engaged with a number of clubs who've got incredibly successful programmes bringing in youngsters from all communities. Drummond Trinity, it would be a good example. I met the chair of Drummond Trinity in Edinburgh, who I think about 93% of their cricketers are from a Southeast Asian background. They've a few years ago they were struggling to put out two cricket teams at the weekend, and now they're putting out five, and they've got a fantastically diverse membership there. So there's lots of great work going on in lots of cricket clubs across the country, and anything we can learn from them in this process, in terms of developing the right culture for the sport, we must learn as much as we can from the pockets of success that are out there already.
So, just sorry,
I have two more members just wanting to come in. Please make it short, Stephanie.
Just on that point there. So, are you actually looking to maybe create opportunities or positions for people like that can really influence the ethos and culture?
Yes, I mean. Positions are how we structure ourselves going forward is a big part of what's going to come out of this governance review. Historically, there's been a board, a Cricket Scotland board that's run the sport, and there's been a Cricket Scotland Council that's been the body that governs the running of the sport on a day-to-day basis. And the board and the council hasn't worked as a governance methodology over the last so many years since it was put in place. I'm not sure exactly how many, but it's maybe 8 or 10 years since that's been in place. In the council, you had representatives of clubs and regions. That's kind of what the council was, and the board tended to be non-executive directors with a commercial background or a governance background or what have you. So how we organise from the top down, from the board right the way down, the representation and the opportunities where people get to put in their input. One of the things I'd love to see is for the sport to have an annual conference where everybody from players, coaches, umpires and other officials, clubs, regions, where everybody can get together once a year and talk about the big issues facing the sport and how we take it forward. I've got a completely open mind as to different ways we can do it, but we need to make sure that we've got really good information flows right the way through from the clubs to the board of directors who run the sport.
Okay, rapidly running out of time, but two members want to ask very short questions. Tess and then Evelyn.
Thank you, convener. Just to share, I was an HR professional for over 30 years. So the optics of you saying that you're deeply disappointed about not being able to hire a comms professional, yet you're not even seriously and see it as a major issue not hiring an HR professional, even part-time. Most organisations, when they want to bring in serious organisational change, put HR at the front. And in preparation for this, I was appalled and saddened to actually see and hear some of the examples. So why are you putting comms as a higher priority than HR? Thank you.
Primarily because we can get good quality support on the HR front in the short term. We need to over-communicate with all our audiences at this point in time, and we really need to be in control of that that communications environment. From an HR perspective, we can get a lot of support from different places, and that will give us time to assess whether we need a full-time resource, whether we need a part-time resource, what skills within the HR mix are the important skills, and what skills can we get in from other places on a long-term basis. If we go out and recruit people now, then they will be permanent employees of the organisation, and if we find in a year's time that we've recruited somebody full-time and we only need them part-time, we won't be able to change that.
I'd just like to say I challenge that, okay. And I'd like to put that for you to reconsider, okay. Even part-time or specialist resource.
Thank you. We are running out of time. Evelyn, please make it short. We must end up.
Okay. Thanks, convener. You've talked about a reset, but when you do reset, who is going to be responsible to make sure we do not get into this situation again? Where does the buck stop?
The buck stops with Cricket Scotland. Cricket Scotland needs to do its governance review and appoint a board and a council, whatever that dynamic might be going forward, that has scrutiny and leadership of the sport, and Sport Scotland's role will be to monitor that and to make sure those changes are in place, and to look at our own interventions to make sure that when we do look, that, you know, we can confidently say the changes that we all want to happen have happened. But it's important that ultimately Cricket Scotland will, and the board of directors will have responsibilities for the sport and for the organisation.
Okay, with that in mind, we may have you back before the start of the next season, just to see how far you've come. And I want to thank you both for your time this morning. We're going to take a short suspension before we move on to our next panel. Thank you. Welcome back. The fourth item on our agenda is an evidence session with integrated joint boards on their experiences of health and social care integration. And a welcome to the committee, all joining us remotely, Stephen Brown, Chief Officer of Orkney Integration Joint Board, Vicky Irons, Chief Officer of Dundee Integration Joint Board, Judith Proctor, Chief Officer of Edinburgh Integration Joint Board and Chair of the Chief Officer Group, and Alan Stevenson, Head of Health and Community Care, Chief Social Work Officer of Inverclyde Integration Joint Board. Good morning to you all. We're going to move straight to questions led by my colleague Paul O'Kane. Paul.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. And I think just in terms of the context of this morning, I think we were keen as a committee to understand the process of integration, essentially, and perhaps looking ahead to our scrutiny of the new National Care Service Bill as proposed, and looking in a retrospective, essentially, as to what is currently operating. And I suppose the story of that, if you like. So I'm going to begin just by asking if we can look back, I suppose, to the time of integration. Do members of the panel feel that planning and guidance for the implementation of integration was suitably clear, detailed and timely? So you know, what was the experience, I suppose, of the planning for that integration process? Sorry, I suppose I should direct that, shouldn't I? I wonder if Vicky wants to comment first.
Yeah, well, certainly from my own perspective, both Judith and I have been engaged in the evolution of the IJBs from the outset during the passage of the bill, but also during the shadow years. I'm currently the Chief Officer for Dundee. However, I was originally the Chief Officer for Angus IGB, both through the shadow year and then through the establishment phase from 2015 onwards. So I feel the process was thorough. The guidance was also thorough. We worked very closely with the civil servants who were based in Scottish Government at the time to develop that really collaboratively so that we could implement arrangements across the system. Most systems had a good year of working in shadow forum, and that year enabled the systems to put in place many of the local agreements that had to be discussed and developed, particularly around the deployment of corporate services, as many of those were not delegated into the new integration authorities, but they were retained by the relevant NHS boards and local authorities, which made up the partnership. Having said that, I think there was still a degree of interpretation present across a number of IGBs in Scotland as to exactly what the governance arrangements and organisational arrangements should look like. But in many cases, we worked through those issues as we developed the integration schemes and as they were processed through Parliament. Many of us were in a position where the original integration schemes required further amendment before they were formally approved. So I feel at the outset there was quite a degree of guidance, and that enabled us to put in place quite robust arrangements. I don't know if my colleague Judith would wish to comment any further from her perspective.
Judith Proctor, Judith.
Very happy to. Integration from the outset, prior to being the Chief Officer in Edinburgh, I was the Chief Officer in Aberdeen City and was involved in the development of the integration scheme and the development of that IJB. I would agree with Vicky, it felt very thorough. We had the bill, then the Act. There was development work with Chief Officers, which enabled us to work together across the country in terms of sharing good practice and understanding what we were each implementing and some of the issues that were arising as we did that. And I think other things that were important to us ultimately included the work that we were able to do with our shadow integration joint boards on establishing the vision, the values, the principles, the way that they wanted to work, and particularly that thing about the added value of what was going to be different and how were we going to implement that. And we were able to set out this strategic vision that then became the strategic plan, and I think set the culture and vision for the integration organisation. And that time in the shadow year felt necessary too for developing the relationships between the partners integration as it was delivered and conceived in that bill was disruptive. You know, it was doing something very, very different. And we needed to re-establish the relationships between councils, health boards and this new organisation. And I certainly feel that the time that we had to do that prior to the go-live date was necessary time. And I do think we had a good amount of support, guidance and time to work together to work through that complexity.
I wonder if I can just move that on slightly in terms of, you know, so that's helpful in terms of understanding, I suppose, the process towards integration. I wonder if we're able to perhaps park the pandemic, sorry for that unfortunate phrase, and I know it's not easy to do, but I'm trying to just get a sense of, did people feel that integration was well established, you know, is absolutely there, or is it still very much feel like a work in progress? And I don't know if maybe Stephen or Alan want to give their observations on that.
We'll go to Stephen first.
Yeah, thanks. I think there was a load of progress made at the time, and as Judith and Vicky described the early days, I think there was a degree of excitement and what was the art of the possible around bringing community-based health and care services together. So I think there was significant strides, but clearly there's still also significant barriers. We talk about information systems getting in the road. We've got loads of information systems across both health and care. It becomes very difficult when sharing information. We've also got different terms and conditions across health and care, and so there's a number of things that would probably leave it to be described as a work in progress.
And we're not able to bring in Alan Stevenson yet, but we're having issues with his connection. So Paul, I don't know if you want to move on.
Yeah. So maybe just to kind of pull this opening segment together. I suppose I'm keen to understand the learning from this process as we move towards another process. So I suppose, what do you feel you know now that you wish you had known at the start of that integration process that can perhaps be used to learn as we scrutinise the forthcoming bill? And we'll maybe go back round.
I could see Vicky Irons nodding along with you, so we'll maybe go to Vicky first. Lesson learnt, Vicky, if you nod along, I'll come to you first. So.
Yeah, so I guess from my perspective, and this might give away the length of time I've been working in these types of roles, this is probably the third set of reforms that we've lived through in similar jobs across health and social care, and that there's a cycle to the learning, I guess. Certainly, I was involved in the predecessor organisations that came before IGBs, including the local healthcare cooperatives and the community health partnerships. And with each of those changes, I think, as my colleagues have outlined, we've seen significant gains in terms of the operational integration of our health and social care services, and really some quite phenomenal work in the way that our teams have operated closely together. But we have struggled with each reorganisation for the rest of the system to fully understand how governance works, to fully embrace, support the integration of health and social care, and to enable us to develop further. So there's something for me about understanding which components of the current health and social care integration legislation have thrived and which other aspects have been inhibited just by the surrounding infrastructure, but also the surrounding environment, if you like, organisationally, that supports that. And it's in these areas, I think, that we need to do quite a lot of work to ensure that we don't necessarily pass those on to the next series of reforms. And I think we also need to understand where we seem to be very good at reviewing organisations such as the IGB as to whether they're working and whether they're succeeding or not, and then replacing them with a new style of organisation. But we fail to really understand the organisational arrangements and the characteristics of the other aspects of the public sector and review those to see if there's any change required there. And I think it's very clear from both the report that was done under the ministerial group around health and social care integration years back now, and then subsequently the Derek Feely review, that health and social care integration has worked phenomenally well in areas where there's been a will to make it work, but it hasn't necessarily thrived in other areas where there hasn't been that level of support and development. And I think it's really these things that we need to concentrate our efforts on, rather than expect another significant organisational change to fix those things. I think they're much more about the culture and the will to make things succeed rather than significant organisational change.
And can I bring in Judith Proctor?
Yeah, I would agree with a lot of what Vicky said there. You know, this is a huge cultural change, and I think one of the lessons that I would take into any consideration about where we go next is the test of whether it truly integrates the operational delivery and receipt of health and social care queer people and communities need to experience it. I think too often we think about structural change at that high level without really testing through what will this mean for real transformation and change at the front line where people are working and at that interface with people's lives. So I think it's important to think about that. And I think, as Stephen had said earlier, many of the things that we weren't able to do and implement it over these 7-8 years were because we remained part of two separate organisations with two separate systems around everything, and that mitigated against that real joint and integrated working at the front line. The fact that we were able to establish that, as well as many areas have done, was despite the arrangements rather than because of them. So I think there's definitely a need to ensure that whatever we put in place next really preserves, strengthens and goes further in that operational integration than perhaps we've been able to do till now.
I think we've got Alan Stevenson back. I'm not entirely sure if we have visually, Alan, but I'm conscious that you probably want to come in on the earlier question that Paul asked, that Stephen responded to. Can we just check to see if we've got you?
Yeah, good morning.
We can hear you great, thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you, and thanks for giving us the opportunity to speak to committee convener. Yeah, the previous questions about that. Sorry, can Paul just repeat the question?
Sure, no worries, Alan. I was really just trying to get a sense of, you know, if we kind of put the pandemic to one side, really, is your sense that integration is well embedded, or is it still very much a work in progress, I suppose, in terms of that wider piece?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I think it's work in progress, although I've been fortunate to work in a number of areas of Scotland, and there is a huge desire to improve outcomes for people, and a lot of the old professional barriers have absolutely gone because people know, no matter which service user or family you're working with, you'll only get those outcomes if we're as joined up as possible. So I think there is still work to go. A number of the partnerships have been working in an integrated way even before the shadow year. So it's important to understand there are organisations who have been trying to push in those boundaries to work closer together. So it will always be work in progress. I think, as my colleagues have said, I suppose the issue for me is we spend a lot of time talking about structures, and we're going to potentially be spending an awful lot of our time initially still discussing structures. And I think people within the service realise that actually if we're focusing on outcomes, there really should be a focus on that is the bit about how we should be spending our time. There's going to be a lot of time spent around all the old barriers in terms of HR and policies and procedures and how things are set up, as opposed to really concentrating on getting better at delivering services to meet people's outcomes. So I don't think any partnership in Scotland will say they're there, but I think there should be an appreciation that there are a number of partnerships going back many years who have been really working to push the boundary, because people accept that not one agency has the answers to provide that assistance and support. We need all the agencies working together. So hopefully that's answered your question, Paul.
Thank you, very helpful.
Thanks, Convener. Tess, you have a question?
I do, thank you. And it's, I'd like to direct it to
Vicky, please, because it builds on something that Vicky just said. So, Vicky, in 1999, there were 79 local health cooperatives, which were replaced by the community health partnerships in 2004. The CHPs were then abolished in 2014, which led to the creation of 31 integration authorities. So you talked about the will to make it work. Was there anything else in terms of lessons learned from the previous failed attempts? And so what lessons were learned, and which issues, in your opinion, are still proving to be problematic? Thanks.
Vicky.
Yeah, OK, thank you very much. So I guess each of those series of reforms that you've just articulated really tried to build on the previous set and understand which things got in the way of that. And I feel with each series of reforms, we've definitely progressed in terms of what we're capable of doing in the integration space. So I would want to say that from the outset. I think it's very, very clear, though, that in establishing the IJBs in particular, the landscape in terms of scrutiny and governance has become quite cluttered. So from a chief officer perspective, it's not unusual for us to have a full set of governance arrangements and reporting arrangements to our integration authorities. That in many cases we have to duplicate that in terms of reporting arrangements both to the relevant NHS board and the local authority. And that can sometimes really just get in the way of being able to effectively fulfil your role, because you spend a huge amount of your time offering assurance and reporting and going through performance management systems of three different organisations. So I think the biggest lesson learned for me is that if there's a change in the way forward, it would be to declutter that landscape and make the governance and accountability arrangements absolutely clear and to try and avoid duplication. In the same sense, though, because each of the authorities that have made up the partnerships have retained ultimate responsibility for the services which are delegated to the Integration Joint Board, there has often been a level of misunderstanding around how the IGB should function and exactly what delegated authority they have. So that experience from my own perspective has been great at some points, but you know, has also changed over time. And that's largely because many of the stakeholders have changed over the period of time that the IGBs have been in place, because we're obviously talking 7 years now that we've been operating. And as individuals change, as stakeholders change across the authorities that you work with locally, so does the level of understanding that underpins the legislation, what we're trying to achieve through integration. So if there's one thing I think that we can learn from this experience, is that we need to make the infrastructure, the governance and the accountability arrangements much clearer. Also, a very particular issue from a chief officer's point of view is it feels very unusual to be accountable in a line management role to the chief executive of the NHS board and of the local authority when you're also in a role as chief officer directing those two authorities to undertake the plans of the IGB. So that can often feel very odd and can sometimes be really quite difficult, particularly around the timing of year when you're trying to agree financial settlements and plans accordingly, because you're part of the NHS board, you're part of the local authority, but your primary role is as chief officer for the IGB. And in many places, we're negotiating with the very body that either employs us or that we're accountable to. So that can sometimes make life quite difficult. I personally have always managed to find a way through that complexity, but I know that it can be quite difficult in other areas where relationships aren't quite as strong as they are in the relationships which I've experienced throughout Tayside.
We have other members wanting to come in on structure and governance, particularly Tess. I'm going to move on to colleagues
Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. I think Vicky made some really strong points there about previous reviews, how things have got better, how you've worked through issues. Am I right in thinking, Vicky, from the comments that you've made, that as we move forward, a lot of what we should be looking at is making governance and accountability more streamlined, taking out duplication? You mentioned, you know, various reporting, etc., maybe doing things more than once in different avenues. And can you maybe expand on that? And I can, could I maybe ask for the other members of the panel to comment as well?
We'll come to Vicky first, and then I'll come to Judith Proctor.
Yes, I mean, the really short answer to that is yes. If we can make things more streamlined, that would make total sense. And there's something in there also about reducing any particular conflict of interest. It does sometimes feel like you're quite conflicted if you're trying to do, if you're trying to participate in the decision making of the NHS board, the local authority, but also do the right thing on behalf of the IGB. Those things don't necessarily always align. So I think it would be very powerful for us to establish the new authority, whatever that looks like in terms of the health and social care boards, to be a board in their own right and not necessarily to be reporting through the other two parts of the public sector structure. I mean, that does have some, I do still have some concerns though about the fit of that, and whether there's enough financial resource to support, you know, essentially three public authorities in the size of Scotland, but also just exactly how that would work out. Because although we've got a very defined series of services which are delegated to the integration authority, those are outlined in our integration schemes, we still work in partnership with a huge range of other services which are retained by the local authority and by the NHS board. So we just need to make sure that we don't cut across any of those partnerships, and that we don't disintegrate the integration which we've already created through health and social care. And I think Judith mentioned something earlier, which certainly strikes a chord with many of us. There's been a large focus on establishing a national care service and ensuring that potentially the new authorities can have direct employment rights for care staff. But we really need to make sure that we can still deploy and integrate all of our health and social care teams that currently form part of the IGBs. And if there's a differential between the new organisation being able to plan and deploy and employ parts of that workforce but not others, I think we worry that that will start to draw some new lines in the landscape. So we just need to really think long and hard about some of those issues and get that right, because we don't want to unpick any of the progress that we've already made. Sorry if I've gone off on a wee bit of a tangent, but it is aligned to, if you like, the organisational structure that we need to look at moving forward.
Can I bring in Judith Proctor, and if our other colleagues want to add anything, if you could please use the chat box, just put an R in the chat box and I can see that because it's in front of me. Judith.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for the question. Again, I agree with Vicky, not for the first time, that simplification and streamlining would be very, very welcome. I think what we're looking to achieve is, you know, agile decision-making so that we can affect real change on the ground for people, and that is to be welcomed, that focus on, you know, developing our services wrapped around individuals, shaped by and co-produced by the many people who need those services. But I don't think our arrangements do that. They are very complex, difficult to navigate within. And I would also question the focus on commissioning change. How much of that change can you commission and direct another organisation that has its own strategic direction to ultimately deliver in a way that is different and responsive to the community? So I think we need to ask questions about that. Stephen's touched on the whole question, I think we all have, of the different terms and conditions, different organisations, different systems. That makes it challenging for our teams on the ground And I think we need to do everything that we can to really streamline things for them. And we talk about this as a real once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to get integration right, to get our care for people right. And I really do think we need to dig into these perennially difficult challenges and really find a way through them, even if it takes some time. But I do think, you know, in relation to those operational arrangements, my own view is they should sit within a single organisation that has the levers, authority and power to direct and deliver those services for the people in that area. Yes, any organisation of that sort would be working very closely with its community planning partners, maximising the potential and opportunities set out, you know, in the Christie report. But I think the arrangements where you try and tie in one organisation to direct others to change and deliver takes time, is difficult, and I don't think delivers the full potential of integration.
Can I bring in Stephen Brown?
And I suppose just building on what Vicky and Judith have already said, from an Orkney perspective in particular, the complexity and the cluttered landscape that both my colleagues have just highlighted is even more evident when we have a population of 22,500. We have the NHS locally, we have the council, we will have a national care service, all with their own chief executives, and that's before you bring in the other community planning partners such as Fire and Rescue and Police Scotland, etc. For our communities who are really looking for the best quality outcomes they can get, for the best quality public services they can get, the whole thing feels very cluttered and very complex, as you can imagine. And I suppose going back to Alan's point earlier, there is no doubt that when we focus our efforts and energies on trying move the outcomes for people. And there's much of the ethos of the National Care Service that's to be welcomed with open arms. I think the move towards a getting it right for everyone approach, in the same way as we've introduced with children's services many years ago. I think the issues around the eligibility criteria, where across the piece we have as public services, across councils and health boards and IJBs, created very strict eligibility criteria that, you know, will provide for people with substantial and critical need. And we end up telling people to come back when they're worse in many instances because we're having to ration our services. And I think the ethos of trying to open that up and provide services and supports at as early a stage makes perfect sense in terms of improving outcomes for people, because the earlier you can get in there, the longer you can them and most successfully. And from an economic standpoint as well, you know, we know going all the way back to the Christie Commission in 2011, the bit around prevention and early intervention, and I'm sure our public health colleagues would tell us likewise in terms of the need to intervene and provide support at as early a stage as possible. I think some of those ethoses that are coming through from the aspirations behind the National Care Service are ones that will help guide us through the difficult discussions and decisions we have to take around the format and the structures, etc.
Thank you. Evelyn, have you got a follow-up question, or can I move on to your colleagues?
I have got a follow-up, convener. Thank you. Stephen, on those points that you made there, thank you. That really helps to clarify how we move forward with work. I'm really interested in the pandemic and how IJBs dealt with that. Did that highlight issues? Did it make, you know, people think about things in a different way? What are our learning outcomes from the pandemic? And how can we move that forward into our future review?
I think it is, I suppose, a personal reflection in many ways, but there's no doubt that at the outset of the pandemic, there were a few things that were different and that brought people together in a way that I had never seen before, in terms of how do we forget about the organisational boundaries, how do we work together effectively. And I think the factors that were at play, first of all, there was a common goal or a common enemy, depending on how you want to view the pandemic. But everyone knew that we needed to respond, we needed to be prepared, and everyone was on board. There was no one in any doubt that this was the right thing to do in terms of making sure that we had everything in place to protect our communities and protect our staff, our services throughout that. I think the second thing was there was no blueprint. There was no established way of doing things, and therefore people were not taking the view, well, we've always done it this way, so that will just stand us in good stead. There was genuinely a blank sheet of paper for people to look at. How do we organise and arrange ourselves in a different way? And nobody pointing to, well, I prefer doing it this way, because there was no established way. And I think the third and final thing was that there was significant governance through the pandemic, no doubt about it. But it was fleet of foot. It was stripped right down to make sure that decisions could be taken at the most appropriate level without taking 3 weeks and, or in some cases 2 years to prepare a business case for a test of change that eventually, by the time that's prepared and ready to be actioned, the world has moved on and things look very different. So there was a fleet of foot that was around at that point that made things very different. And those three factors, I think, are things that we need to be very clear about. So when you focus on what is our ultimate goal, what is our outcome that we want to achieve, and getting everybody on board is one thing. Allowing people the space to think about, if we had a blank sheet of paper and we're creating our public services from scratch, what would that look like to best effect? Because we find ourselves bolting things on and trying to join bits up. But if we had a blank sheet of paper, it would make a big deal of difference. And the third thing, and it goes back to Vicky's point about the real complexity of governance, etc., that can be really tricky through all of this. And if we can streamline that and some of the bureaucracy, that would free people up to focus on the things that really matter, which is about improving the outcomes for the people of Scotland.
Vicky Irons wants to come back in, and I've got a very short question picking up on some of the points by Paul O'Kane. So I'll go to Vicky first of all.
Yep, thank you very much for your question. And really, just to build on Stephen's points, I would go further and say that if we didn't have foundation that we had established through our health and social care partnerships, I think the response to the pandemic would have looked markedly different. And I still very vividly recall the first few months of the pandemic response, mainly because I'd only been in post in Dundee for 3 weeks at that point. But what was really evident was, because we had really robust and integrated teams, because we have teams who are self-starting, you know, who don't necessarily require huge amounts of direction to do the right thing, I think the resilience response that was mobilised was really quite phenomenal. And within those first few weeks, as an example, our GP out of hours service established a treatment and assessment centre on the very, very first weekend that we realised that there was going to be a problem with COVID. We were also integral to the development of our testing services for all staff and latterly for the public as that rolled out. And indeed, further down the line in terms of the pandemic, the vaccination service. But I guess the key thing that we all need to remember is that in those early days, we were doing everything within our power to protect the capacity that we had available in our acute hospitals. But what that essentially meant was that the majority of people's care needs needed to be met in the community. And that was both a very frightening time for our staff, but also quite an exhilarating time for our staff, because they maintained the care that people have in their own homes. They maintained the care that we were providing through our care homes. And I think they did that very, very well. And just to reiterate Stephen's points, when you move into resilience mode, it does make decision-making much quicker, much easier. And I think we were welcomed into the kind of local resilience partnerships with open arms in terms of mobilising the efforts across our local communities. So I just felt it was worth reiterating that.
Alan, you wanted to come in on this?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just to build on the point from Vicky and others, I mean, the level of flexibility and resilience when COVID struck, the level of fear in our community about our staff groups stepped forward into the brink, and whether that was our district nurses, our care at home staff, our colleagues in the third sector. I think I've never seen, I have 25 years as a social worker, but I've never seen the system coming together so well as I had in those early days, because the level of uncertainty, but our staff stepped up, and staff from the Health Board, we had staff from Inverclyde Council who came forward asking, can we get some training to come and help with care at home? So, and as well as that, our third sector colleagues stepped in to set up like the humanitarian helpline, so that people that were able to get a response from people, we could really enhance that offer that the statutory services were able to do, but really through the partnership working of the wider system. So that will be one of the things that will always be in my head, have come through this experience of the whole system reacting to this and stepping up and saying, how can we help to keep the most vulnerable people safe, that flexibility and that agility. And similarly to Vicky, within the first few weeks, we'd set up a testing centre in Port Glasgow at the side of the health centre. We then had the army in to help us. So all these things are just coming one after the other, but the staff across all levels of the organisation, from the leadership and through the whole leadership, through service managers, team leaders, or staff on the ground, that will be my memory from this, about how people stepped forward. They put their own fears to the side, and that whole system response is something we should never forget. In fact, celebrate and think about what that tells us about the capacity we have moving forward into this latest iteration of what the new National Care Service might look like. So I think it needs to be a response not just from the statutory services, but our wider group of colleagues who are far and wide and have got a vast amount of experience, and a lot of the answers lie in that wider response to health and social care moving forward.
Thank you, Alan. Paul, you have a short question.
Thanks. Yeah. So we've heard there, I think, about the local working in terms of officer level, but I'm just keen to understand a perspective about the actual board itself and how important people feel that essentially that kind of democratic representation of elected members being able to scrutinise the work of the IGB, or the Health and Social Care Partnership, sorry, and the work of you as a chief officer is, people who know their communities, have been elected to represent their communities. And I say this as someone who served on an IGB in a previous life, but I wonder if Judith might want to share her view on that.
Indeed. Thank you for the question. And I think, you know, the makeup of your board and their interest in the work that you're doing is crucially important. And I think what's really central to that is the board has its own personality. It is a public body in its own right. And I've certainly, in both IJBs I've worked with, really tried hard with the chair and the vice chair and all members of that board to create that culture of, this is not two different types of appointed people, elected members and non-execs coming together with those hats on to make decisions through that lens. They are there as an integration joint board, work for the community in their area, and to think differently and to think beyond the boundaries of the organisations that they come from. That's really, really important. And of course, the other part of the board that's hugely important to us is the non-voting members. And certainly in Edinburgh, the approach that we take is we're a board of everybody who's round that table. Yes, some ultimately will vote if we need to vote, if we have only had a vote. I think on one occasion, we make decisions through consensus broadly that we're doing the right thing and that we've got agreement to the proposals that we're putting forward. So the voices of lived experience, people who work within our services, from our professional representatives, is hugely important in helping that whole board make its decision. And I think the role of local democracy, of course, is really important. We link through the elected members who sit on the board, but of course they are not representing their communities and their constituents when they're on the board. But we try very hard to work with our local politicians, including those that aren't on the board, because of course the experience, the knowledge that they bring from those localities, from their casework, is hugely important. Our understanding of how our services impact people on the ground and how sometimes we get it wrong, where we can do better. So I think working through local democracies is hugely important, as is also working with third sector organisations, community groups, and the people that represent those groups. So yes, I think it's really, really important. We've taken very seriously the planning at the level of your locality and the way that you work with your communities. Edinburgh is a large, very diverse city. So we tried to work through localities to ensure that as far as we're able to, we shape our services to those communities and the needs in those communities. I think the experience and knowledge of local elected members, including those that sit on the board, is really important in that. But I think for me as a chief officer for an IGB, more important is that board recognises that it is a public body in its own right, decisions that it has to make that may sit. I think Vicky talked about tension earlier. The role and the decisions of elected members that sit on the IGB can be sometimes, as you may have experienced yourself, counter to the views and directions of your group in the council or of the whole council. And I think it's quite a difficult role for elected members and indeed for non-exec NHS directors to sit on that board and to hold in their head the ambitions of that board and driving those forward through strategic planning through its direction.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm just asking everyone to be mindful of time in both the length of their questions and their answers. We've got a tremendous amount of questions still to ask. And if I can have our panellists, maybe if they want to add anything to what's already been said, to use the chat box to do so. Can I move on to questions from Gillian Mackay?
Just one from me. I'll maybe go to Vicky on this one. What impact does any confusion of lines of accountability have on the planning, quality and delivery of services?
I think the major impact is pace of change, because if there is an expectation that the pathway of any significant decisions have to go through both the health board and the local authority as well as the IGB, it just affects your ability to make decisions timeously. So I think that's the major impact. I guess it also depends on, though, whether there is a different sense of priorities across the two public sectors which make up the health and social care partnerships and which have formed the IGBs. And where that's the case, it can also have an impact just in being able to align those priorities to be able to move forward with decision making.
Thank you. And Tess, you have a question.
Yes. Thank you, convener. COSLA said in their response to the National Care Service Bill consultation, and I'm just going to do a straight quote, and then I'd like Alan and Stephen to just give a quick response after, please. So COSLA said structural change typically fails to address long-standing systemic barriers, with integration being challenged by lack of resource, infrastructure and staff. As things stand, we risk repeating the cycle of successive reorganisations that change how services are planned and coordinated, but fail to address the fundamental and deep-rooted changes needed to integrate services at the front line. So my question, firstly to Alan and then to Stephen, please, is are you concerned that all your hard work over the last few years could be undone? Thank you.
Thank you. And you wanted to go to Alan first.
Yes, please.
Convener, thank you for that question. I think Inverclyde's IGB's response to the committee we submitted did talk about the fear that we spend a lot of time going back over things we really shouldn't be spending time on, and we should be taking the learning that we've had from these successive changes. So I think there is a worry, a fear, which wasn't there initially. I think when the National Care Service issue came up again, there was a great deal of enthusiasm and excitement, but I think with the passage of time, it's been more and more of a concern that we will spend too much time thinking through some of the things that we already know the answers to. So I think there is a fear that a lot of energy will be spent in relation to structures when we should be looking at outcomes. And I think it is for us now to make sure we play a full role in this as the thinking develops with the senior leaders and other parts of the services across Scotland to make sure we shape this properly, because I think COSLA are only highlighting some of the genuine concerns that many of my colleagues that I work with have spoken about, and the potential to score an own goal, if you like, if you don't make the most of this opportunity. So yes, I think there is a fear there, and I think it's reasonable that really experienced senior leaders who have been through many changes would have that fear. And I think really we need to make sure we are shaping this moving forward.
Can I ask just before I bring in your colleague, are you being given that opportunity? You said to be involved in shaping the National Care Service.
I think now there's ongoing conversations now moving forward, which people that Judith and Vicky have been involved in through our different bodies that represent us. We also have our Chief Social Work Officer group. So there's a lot of weight being put on all the things we're going to start talking about now moving forward, and we've been assured that we will have our opportunity to shape this moving forward. So we look forward to be at the centre of this discussion moving forward. We are committed to making this work. So I don't think any of my colleagues would say they are not interested in playing a full part in this moving forward. So I think the challenge is there in front of us now to be fully informed on how we shape this moving forward.
Thank you. And can I bring in Stephen?
Yes, thanks. I would agree with Alan to a certain extent that there's certainly a nervousness that we spend a lot of time, effort and energy looking at our structures at a time when we absolutely need to be focused on the needs of our communities across the piece. And we recognise that having come through two of the most difficult years, for all of the reasons that everyone around the table will know, through the most difficult years through the pandemic. We know that many of our older people became deconditioned through that period. We know that many of the routine operations that we had to put on hold and the impact of that. We know that we had the impact on people's mental health. And as we emerged from the pandemic, there is always that emerging need that comes out as a result of that, and we need to be extremely focused on it. And likewise, when we add in the financial instability across the world, the cost of living crisis that people are facing, the impact that can have on people's mental and physical well-being and health, there is absolutely a need for us to be outward focused in terms of our efforts. And I suppose that bit around how much time do we spend on huge structural change again, and it's getting the balance, because there's no doubt that structural change can make a difference. Vicky highlighted quite clearly at the outset the significant impact of the changes that we made for the establishment of the integration joint boards in the first place, and the progress that was made through the early days of that. And I think that there's no doubt that structures can help facilitate the work that we do, but it's getting the balance, I think, around being outward focused and at the same time making sure that we have the proper structures in place to help us deliver that.
Thank you. And move on to questions from Stephanie Callaghan. Stephanie.
Thank you, Convener. Around leadership, chief officers, I think Vicky gave a really good description of how difficult that role is when they're subordinate to chief executives of other bodies there. And we did have our ministerial strategic group talking about how they must improve collaborative working. So my questions are, how are they currently supported, our chief officers of integration joint boards? And how do we help them? What changes do we need to make so that they have the power to lead effectively?
Judith, that seems like a good question to put to yourself.
Yeah.
Thank you, and thank you for that question, because I think it does recognise the uniquely difficult role that chief officers have in health and social care and integration in Scotland. And I think all leadership roles at this level could be challenging, but I think there's certainly a unique aspect to the multiple lines of accountability that you have as a chief officer that make that difficult. I think there's a number of things in that. I think, first of all, there's a needs to be a recognition that across the public sector in Scotland, we want to see leaders come forward, we want to see them be able to be developed, we want to see them thrive in these roles and to have opportunity within that. So I think there's a really important thing for us as a system to be thinking through around succession planning, where are the opportunities for leaders coming through And I know that there are some new approaches to that, the delivering strategic leadership programme that's just starting, I think, this week. I think it's a really important part of that that's looking cross-sector. So I think in terms of the current cohort of chief officers, we as a group in Health and Social Care Scotland try and support one another. We are back together again in person with some development days where we're trying to develop our role as an organisation and as a group in terms of that collective voice of chief officers. How do we influence the wider system? Because sometimes it can be quite difficult in your own system to undertake that influencing because of the multiple tensions there. So I think that's important. But I think there has to be that recognition that where chief officers in that role require support, that we have a route into Scottish Government. And again, we try and work with officials there to cultivate that. But I think the crucial one here is being able to prepare and support leaders in the future and for a kind of national approach to that and to their development.
Stephanie?
Fantastic. Thank you. That was really, really helpful there. Does it seem to be that actually this is at the centre of the high turnover of leadership in IJBs? Is there anything else in addition to what you've said there that we should be doing to try and prevent that from happening going forward?
That's a difficult one. I think there's two interpretations of the high turnover in chief officers. And one of those is, and we've seen it actually, that a number of chief officers have gone into from what we might think of as promotional posts as chief executives of local authorities and of health boards. So I think there is something to celebrate in terms of the experience of doing this challenging job, preparing you to develop as a leader in public sector in Scotland. But I think it's undoubtable that some attrition has come about because of the difficult multiple reportings. And I think some of the questions earlier about simplification, streamlining, being able to ensure that chief officers can represent the change that they're trying to deliver and represent their organisations clearly is going to be really important in the new arrangement so that voice is not compromised by any of the tensions inherent in the current model.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Emma, you have some questions around performance.
Yes.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to everyone and thanks for coming today. Some couple of questions about performance. Integration authorities have been required to report on a core suite of integration indicators within their annual performance reports. And the indicators were developed to allow integration authorities to review progress towards health and wellbeing outcomes. And just looking at the frameworks and the papers, they seem pretty straightforward. So I'm interested to know if you think that appropriate measures and indicators are in place to basically track the progress of integration. And if not, is there something that you would suggest that should be added that might be more appropriate?
And who would you like to direct that to initially?
I think Vicky or Judith first.
If we go to Judith.
Thank you. We do use a core suite of indicators, and I think on balance they are useful as indicators to tell us how we're doing, both in terms of our local progress. So how well have we performed in Edinburgh since the inception of integration? Are we going in the right direction? Helpful for that, but also so you can see your relative position across the rest of Scotland. Most of us will add into our annual performance reports other local relevant parameters and indicators that we think are useful. So I think you will get that local flavour, and we will all have in place a local performance framework that goes beyond the annual performance reports. We'll be developing one of those that goes into those services. Obviously, those partnerships that go beyond the bare minimum within the integration scheme will include in their performance delivery of justice services, the performance of children's services, etc. So that will need to be reflected. I think one of the hardest things, though, to reflect in any sort of indicator at that level is the experience of people on the ground. We've talked here before in this committee and in its previous incarnation about how you measure the impact of prevention and early intervention. And I think we do struggle in being able to articulate what are good indicators around that. And of course, some of the longer term change that we're trying to put in place in terms of health inequalities, reducing that, reducing the impact of health inequalities and narrowing the gap, they're harder to implement. And for us, certainly, and we won't be alone in this in Edinburgh, some of the challenges in that is the resource to deliver that level of complex analysis of your population. And so I think there's always room for change and improvement in this, but I think the suite that we've got, it's been useful, it's been the same one that we've used over the years, and certainly, you know, we're able to measure progress against some challenge against some, for us it remains delayed discharges, but you know, we're seeing progress against those indicators. I think if we're going to change them, it will be important to take forward some of the ones that we're using now, so we don't start with a completely fresh page and we can't measure the progress from where we're going now into the future and whatever the new arrangements are.
Emma? Thanks for that response. When you mention like particular local issues that you measure, I think that probably is quite important. Like for rural versus urban areas, I'm thinking about integration authorities like Dumfries and Galloway and Scottish Borders are pretty rural. So are you able to give a particular example of what local performance measurements you used and you know, and successes that you feel have been really good that obviously need to be reported on so that we can continue to look at how to build on successes?
Yeah. So we'll look at the variance between our localities. We operate as four localities in Edinburgh, again, to try and ensure that we're planning and delivering at a level that's kind of realistic. Now, our four localities are very large. There's as large as some other partnerships in terms of the population that they cover, but at least it gives us a greater opportunity to respond to those communities within that locality. So we look at and report on the variance and difference in those localities, and that helps us really think through the relative amount of resource that we might put to one area as opposed to another. It helps us think where we need to undertake some quality work, where we need to achieve a degree of consistency of approach so that we're delivering the same outcomes for people there as we are in other areas. So that's one area where I think it's important that we're looking at our population, at our structures, and reporting on the changes there. And we're seeing things and looking at, for example, you know, the levels of welfare guardianship in some areas being higher than others. And that can have an impact on our performance, and it has an impact on the resource that we need there. So that would be one area that I would point to that it's very, very helpful. Thinking locally and responding to what we find.
Thank you. Vicky Irons wants to come in on that.
Yeah, it's just to briefly build on that, and I think likewise I would agree with Judith that the evolution of the annual report and the performance measures that are within that are a useful and continuous method in which the IGB can gauge whether we have been making progress. But I think it's also fair to say that there have been lots of service development which have evolved since we did establish those requirements that aren't necessarily covered. So what I witnessed through the local IGB is a request for information which is certainly more up to date, because that process in itself can be considerably out of date in terms of the data capture, by sometimes a year or 18 months, but also a request for us to be able to represent the work that we do. And that would be one thing that I would want to emphasise in moving forward into new arrangements. Many of the activity performance measures that we're judged against essentially look at voids or waiting lists, and it identifies all the work that we're not doing. And there's often a particular focus, it feels like, from a chief officer perspective, the only measure that we're ever judged on is our delayed discharge figures. That doesn't necessarily reflect the activity which we do really successfully. And to give you an example of that, although the delayed discharge figures in my own health and social care partnership would, to many people externally, look quite constant, i.e. they would look like they're not necessarily improving, that masks a 20% increase in demand that we have covered and that we are providing care for. We also now have a new measure that's come into place which is around discharge without delay, and that gives an indication that Dundee's performance is between 97-99% for the number of people who we discharge without any delay at all. So for me, the emphasis moving forward needs to value things that we do well, that we can report back on, as well as performance measures that count the things that we don't necessarily do and that, you know, we're continuing to try to improve on.
We heard during the pandemic how that you had some teams that are really self-starting, and there's been good experience of how to support, you know, getting people out of the hospitals was one issue that happened in the early part of the pandemic. So just hear your thoughts, I suppose, about integration partners and whether they all collaborate effectively. And that would be to look at how to improve performance based on the outcomes and the data indicators. So, and obviously, if there are challenges, how do you foresee overcoming them? Ricky?
So, again, from my own experience, that's one of the areas which has really thrived under the integration, in that the teams that, if you like, support pathways of care, whether that's from the care of the elderly consultants within the acute sector right through to primary care practitioners and the third sector, which Judith has mentioned, literally are all pulling in the same direction. We have completely integrated teams available across the localities, certainly within Dundee City, and I know that that's the case in other partnership areas, who work on a cycle of continuous improvement. Because the challenge, the demand for our services never stands still. And certainly we've all witnessed quite an increase in the level of complexity of the people that we need to support, but also the volume of people who are requiring care through our systems, literally from end to end. So we have a completely integrated process in place across the pathway, and our teams are integrated in the way that they're deployed on a daily basis. So if you like, the level of improvement, the level of collaboration that you're asking about is present, without a shadow of a doubt in my mind, and it's present on a daily basis. So we need to safeguard that and make sure that that forms part of the foundations of whatever arrangements come into place next.
Vicky, I would like to pick up on something you said in your earlier answer to Emma Harper about how the focus on delayed discharge can in fact mask quite a lot of the positive things that are being achieved, the flow of an increased amount of people, you know, out of hospital and into care settings and getting the support they need from IJB and the people that you employ. One of the things we hear a lot is that people are not coming into the care sector, or people are leaving the care sector because they feel demoralised. Do you think that fact that the performance, the good performance and the achievements that have been made, as you say, in a very challenging situation where you're meeting that demand, you think that the way that's been reported in the public discourse is part and parcel of the fact that you have these challenges in terms of people's morale?
Yes, if I can respond without a shadow of a doubt. I think the reality of being under constant scrutiny, but also feeling like you're on the end of a continual kind of stream of criticism, can be very demoralising. And I think these are increasingly really tough jobs to be able to fulfil, dealing with lots of people with cognitive impairment, lots of complexity in terms of care needs, and dealing with everything that surrounds that, including the pace in which you're required to work for us to be able to ensure that people's pathways of care, that we're providing care at the right place at the right time, and that people aren't delayed at any part of our system. So I think that does have a major impact as well. I think my colleague Stephen also mentioned something earlier about what it feels like to be providing a role, particularly in care, and particularly care at home, where you can be quite isolated in the job that you undertake and that you provide for others. And there's something there about, there's a perception now that these are very stressful roles, but they carry quite a level of risk. And Stephen mentioned it, I still think we have a legacy of it following the pandemic. There were times when our workforce were genuinely frightened that the jobs that they were undertaking were putting themselves at risk, were putting their families at risk, but that, you know, that, but at the same time, they were under quite a steady stream of criticism for performing those roles. So we have to understand that. We are also seeing signs of trauma across the workforce. So we're now trying to develop trauma-informed support services to make sure that people get the respite, but also the support they need to be able to continue in their roles. And we have seen a high level of turnover as a result of that.
And just to follow up on that, what do you think the likes of us as politicians and anyone, you know, from the media and the press and the people that are reporting on these things can do to try and recognise more, not just that it's a hard job, but it's actually a really important job, and it's a rewarding job, and it's something that we should be trying to be more positive to encourage people to stay and to thank people who do that very hard work.
I mean, I think a lot of that comes with you know, true recognition for the roles that people undertake. And I'm sorry if I've misremembered this, but I think there was something in the Feely report about parity of esteem as well. And for the role of people in caring roles to be valued, not just by ourselves, by yourselves, but also by the public as, you know, professional roles and essential roles as part of the health and social care spectrum. I think that sometimes it's felt that particularly clinical roles, medical roles, nursing roles are held with held in a higher esteem, let's say. So I think there's something we can do both to raise the profile of what people do, but also to value that and reward that and recognise that.
Thank you. And I see that Judith Proctor wants to come in. I'll come to Judith and then I'll come to Alan.
Yes, thank you. And I think it's a very good question and so important. And I think that is one of the lessons that I learned through the pandemic, is the absolute value and importance of these roles in people's lives. And I think there's practical things that we can do. You know, we can think about terms and conditions. I think that is important. This is a difficult job. We should value it in the way that, you know, people experience doing it. But I think there's also something about how we create career pathways into and from care into other roles. And I know that most of us as chief officers in our partnerships and with our health boards and councils are looking at that. And I think also as a nation, we'll have to open the conversation about what it means to be a carer. I think some of the images that we see are probably not very realistic. You know, you'll see recruitment campaigns where somebody's having a cup of tea with somebody. Now, that does happen, but it is also a very, very high pressurised role. And I think we need to show it and shine a light on the real work and importance that it has there. And again, I would just I'd welcome what was said in the Feely report about this, because I think Feely did absolutely recognise the need for us to elevate our support and esteem for these crucially important roles.
Thank you. And can I bring in Alan?
Yeah, thanks, convener. Judith just covered the point. I suppose there is a more of a focus on health and wellbeing for our staff now, and each of the partnerships have put a lot of time and effort into looking at how we can support our staff groups around their health and wellbeing, because it's undoubtedly people are tired. They are emotionally tired, they're physically tired coming through the last 2 years. Many of the partnerships have got active recruitment campaigns. In Inverclyde, we have one for our care at home service kicked off last week again to try and encourage people to think about a career in care. There's far more opportunities to move in and care at home, and there'll be other things you can do after that. But a big, big focus on health and wellbeing has to be the way forward. And I don't think, I can remember when EWI, Adults with Incapacity, came in as a mental health officer. The Scottish Parliament does have a role. You can bring in innovative legislation, and I know there's been issues with AWI now, but certainly, I think someone asked the role of the Scottish Parliament. Well, yes, there is a big role for that in terms of legislation can be helpful, and I think there's a huge challenge for us now supporting the staff across. No one comes in to be a registered social worker to be popular. People know it comes with the territory, but we need to protect our staff, whether it's district nurses or whether it's allied health professionals. The level of disquiet amongst some people in the community now towards our staff has been an issue for us, and we've had to work really hard to make sure that we are doing everything we can to promote health and wellbeing. And I think the committee would want to know about the health and wellbeing work that's going on across Scotland to support our staff in whatever role their current people are working in across health and social care.
Thank you very much. Can I come to questions that Tess White has around strategic planning?
Thank you, Convener. Alan Stevenson said that people are tired and we've been through a very difficult period in the last 2 years. So my question is, what work is going on at the moment to integrate service delivery? Has it stalled? And has the National Care Service Bill detracted resources away from forward planning in this area? So my question is about bandwidth. Thank you.
Okay. Will we go to Judith on that? Judith.
Sorry, you cut out there for me for a second. Would you mind just briefly repeating the question?
Just very, very quickly. So my question, Judith, is about bandwidth. So, and everybody's tired and fatigued after the last 2 years. So the question is, what work is going on at the moment to integrate service delivery? And has the National Care Service Bill prevented forward planning in this area? Because there's only so much you can do. Thank you.
Thank you for that question, for repeating it for me. I think there's a real risk of that we focus on, you know, what we need to do to work towards the National Care Service, and we not exactly take our eye off the ball of what we're doing now, but it disrupts our ability to look in the longer term. I mean, ideally, with our strategic planning, we'll be looking beyond the three-year cycle that we have and into 10 years, what we want to achieve. And I think you can kind of integrate that with the intent around the bill and the Derek Feely report, and we can be working as we already are on things like ethical commissioning. You know, that should be a principle of how we commission anyway, so that should not be knocked off course by the work around the National Care Service. But I think as more of the detail around the NCS is made available and comes through the co-production process, I think it is a real risk that we begin to feel the tension in terms of current direction of travel, planning, relationships, allocations of budget. I think it's a real issue here, and what we're required to do around the National Care Service. Questions at the start of this session to us were all focused on the processes of when we integrated back in 2015, 2016. And at that point, of course, we had Change Fund support us. We were able to increase our capacity, do some double running of that sort of element of our work. And I think, again, those arrangements, how we're supported to potentially double run as we transition from our current situation to the future be really important. So I do think there is a risk, and I think, you know, we're experiencing some of that issue with bandwidth now, because we all have a longer term direction of travel to create sustainable, transformed health and social care services within the challenging sort of budgets that we have. But we're also now needing to focus significantly on winter planning, which is now a year-round activity, really, that surge planning, the uncertainty of future waves of COVID. We now have almost permanent focus on vaccination programme, which is hugely important, and just the sheer challenge that we all have in addressing this stage of the pandemic and the consequences of the previous 2 years. So I think that bandwidth issue doesn't just relate to the NCS, but just to the sheer pressure and demand and need for change.
Thank you. And I'm going to bring in Sandesh, who's joining us remotely.
Thank you, Convener. I actually have to say, listening to Vicky Iron speaking, as a doctor, I am also very confused about IJBs and where they sit and the confusion of authority, no clear guidance, governance, and where the lines of accountability are. That makes real sense to me, what you were saying. My question's about Audit Scotland said that a clearer line about care boards superseding integration authorities would be beneficial in the National Care Service Bill. They said this would assist current integration authorities with medium and longer term planning. Question is, do you agree with this? And are you concerned that the NCS Bill, as drafted, is undermining such medium and longer term planning?
And who would you like to go to first, Sandesh?
Vicky, please.
Yeah, thanks for your question. I guess two things. In terms of the undermining of the medium to long-term planning, I think that potentially builds on Judith's response to the previous questions. And there is absolutely a requirement. Our planning cycle is pretty much continuous these days, but particularly after COVID, I think each IGB has had to go through a refresh of our strategic plans just to ensure, first of all, that we can bank the gains we've made in terms of integration throughout the resilience response, but that we understand exactly how demand has changed as a result of COVID, and that we can refresh our strategic plans and respond to that. And I mentioned earlier on, particularly for care at home, we've seen a 20% surge in demand, which can't be explained by demographic change. It's something else has shifted throughout that period. But I think there's something my colleague said earlier, colleague Stephen said earlier, which is perhaps not present at the moment and is a bit of a risk in terms of the interruption of that planning cycle. And that's the level of excitement that was there when we were first established. I think there was a real desire to do things very, very differently, and an excitement around change and an excitement around integration and what progress could be made. I think that's been dampened down recently, and I think some of that is because of the fear of change ahead, to a certain extent wondering if we go for really significant strategic shifts in care, whether there might be a point in time in the next couple of years where the rug might be kind of pulled from underneath that. So I think there's potentially a risk there. And that's more about feelings than any in particular kind of infrastructural planning process that we have in place. But it's essentially the role of a chief officer to make sure that motivation is still present and that all of our partners are willing to tie into that. So that's our challenge, I feel, to be able to see us through this period of change, and we're certainly up for that challenge. I think your other question there was about the Audit Scotland reflections on, if you like, the streamlining of accountabilities. And I guess I do agree with that in general terms, but if I can maybe flag up another area of concern and that comes from a chief officer perspective, is that the possible development as of a national care service in parallel to a national health service is of concern, and we are worried that we're going to lose the gains of all the work we've done around the integration of health and social care. And from a personal perspective, I think we've maybe missed an opportunity in not building a national health and social care service as opposed to two parallel national bodies and two parallel boards that will be present in local systems. So that's one of the areas where I think there's potentially been a missed opportunity in the proposals that have been set out so far.
Okay, we're going to move on to talk about collaboration with third and private sectors, and questions from Paul O'Kane.
Convener, I wonder if I can just start by asking again for another reflection, I suppose, on integration, and to what extent has legislation and guidance allowed for effective collaboration with the third and private sector?
And who would you like to ask that to?
I wonder if we can maybe go to Stephen first.
Yeah, thanks for the question. I think it has helped facilitate the relationships across statutory, third and independent sector. There's no doubt, and it's been described earlier in the session, the makeup of the joint boards, the input of various bodies and key stakeholders, from service users and carers through to our trade unions, our staff side and our third and independent sector representatives. And I think all of that has helped shape the delivery models across the piece. From an Orkney perspective, we don't have an independent sector. We have a real thriving, mainly locally based, third sector, who are incredibly valuable to the system and the work that they do, and are truly integrated, not just with our health and social care landscape, but right across the community planning partnership arena, and are very active partners within that. So just as an example, for us, our delivery of distress brief interventions, for example, it's the third sector that helped lead on that. The delivery of many of our pathways around dementia diagnosis, it's Age Orkney Scotland to work in collaboration with psychiatry and social work, etc., to deliver upon that too. So all of that, I think, continues to thrive under the current circumstances. I do think that the legislation, as had been laid out, and the makeup of the integration joint boards and the approach to strategic planning has certainly, in my experience, assisted some of that collaboration.
Thank you. And no one else has asked to come in this, Paul, so I'll throw back to you. And if anyone wants to come in, then please use the chat box and let me know and I'll come to you.
Yeah, we've touched on some of this already, I think, in terms of the governance and the scrutiny within IGBs, and having essentially different partners around the table and a place at the table, particularly for third sector, but also obviously for trade union colleagues and others. I wonder to what extent the panel feel that people being present but being asked to leave sometimes when the vote happens, or being present at the table and not having a vote, to what extent that actually, I suppose, maybe frays or can fracture relationships in terms of that kind of meaningful contribution that people can make.
Go to Judith, if we can just get her mic live, please. There we are. We should be able to hear Judith. Although there we are.
Sorry, yes, happy to come in on that one, because I think it is a really important one. I think, certainly from my own experience, an individual would only be asked to leave the meeting room when a decision had been made if there was a potential conflict of interest through their register of interests. And as I've said before, we've worked very, very hard, previous chairs, vice chairs of the IGB, to act as a whole board and to make decisions by consensus has definitely been an approach that we've taken in Edinburgh. As I say, we've only ever had one vote, and that related to the day of the week that we were going to be meeting. So I think from that, our non-voting members articulate a sense of being part of the decision making and having an equal voice around the board. Now, we do talk about it because, of course, they feel like they've got an equal voice around the board, but in the legislation they don't. And so I think that has to be really explored. But of course, the challenge around that for any individual undertaking that role is one of their representation and how representative of a community, etc., that they are. But I think what we've seen by having those voices around the table is a far richer, better, reflective conversation about things that are very, very challenging. And I think it helps us with those difficult, innovative, challenging things to then work with our workforce and work with our communities in terms of their implementation, because we've worked through some of the issues with those voices already in the room.
Thank you. And can I bring in Alan Stevenson before I move on to final questions from Carol Mockin? Alan.
Thanks, Convener. Just interesting, similar to Judith and Inverclyde, we've not had to have a vote, which is quite remarkable when you think of the complexity of some of the issues that we've discussed, because very much the work as a team And it's interesting, the new National Care Service is talking about that, a change in that in relation to everyone having their vote. During the shadow year, it was a bit of a, folk were quite concerned about the vote and how it was split. In my experience, having had worked in Argyll and Bute for 13 years now and Inverclyde for 5, it really hasn't been as big an issue as some people might think. And we've always managed to work in a way that people around the table have all had the opportunity to contribute, and that shapes their decision making. So I think it's an interesting discussion. It's reared its head in the new National Care Service again about broadening out that voting, but certainly in Inverclyde we've not had to go to a vote on any of these issues because we've worked together with the IGIB members. You have things like development sessions out with the IGIB. There's particularly pieces of work that are people are really feel there might be problems with. IGIBs will put development sessions on so that the chief officer can then work through some of these issues in a non-committee, if you like, a place where folk can ask all the questions, get their assurance, and then when you come together, it's more likely that you'll get that joint response from people because I've had that opportunity to be involved in that discussion.
Thank you. And can I move on to questions from Carol Mockin on financial integration? Carol.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, panel members. I think everyone would recognise that over the time that we've been integrated, financial integration has been one of the key factors that have been difficult. And I wondered whether each of the panel members might just take a little bit with hindsight to discuss why they think that has been the case. And also realistically, with the government saying there are financial strains ahead, going forward, how likely is it that we can achieve better financial integration and actual budgeting as well, how we get these two organisations to work together on the budgeting? Thank you.
We'll maybe go to Judith first of all, and if anyone else wants to come in, please use the chat box so that I can see you. Judith.
Yeah, it is complex, the financial planning and budgeting within the integration arrangements that we have. We try very hard as chief officers, and I'll speak my own personal experience, to work in parallel with the financial planning arrangements and timelines of both our partner organisations. But of course, our NHS board and our council both work quite differently in terms of their budget setting and have got different statutory requirements on them in relation to that. The best way through this, in my experience, is about really solid tripartite arrangements and relationships between us as IGB officers, myself, my chief finance officer, and with the directors of finance in both the council and the NHS board. And we have monthly meetings where we're able to, you know, really air all the issues that we have and work on the basis of no surprises, and to support the robust discussions that we need to have as an IGB, and the influence that we must try and bring to bear in our partner organisations in terms of the allocations that we think are fair. Our biggest challenge in Edinburgh is the structural deficit. At the point when this board was set up, there was a £25 million gap that we've never managed to repair. So we've got very significant year-on-year savings to achieve at the same time as we're trying to develop services and sustain. So there's some very, very difficult decisions that have to be made through that. That requires the IGB members to really, really work hard together with us as officers in terms of, you know, identifying savings programmes that can be delivered without undermining our ultimate strategic direction and which don't cause us to reduce performance beyond a level at which it's acceptable. So very, very challenging. And I think one of the issues around this, of course, is the landscape is very challenging for both our councils and our health boards as well. We're all in the same game. And I think that's why it's really important to do that planning together. In terms of the future position, I think, again, it comes down to streamlining. I think it comes down to really looking at the arrangements that we have in place and working through if we really want to create the agility of services close to people to achieve the outcomes that we're trying to. How do we reduce the bureaucracy and the time spent on budget setting in this way within these new organisations? I think certainly Derek Feely had referred to, you know, direct budgets to these new organisations as one of the ways of doing that. And I would anticipate that would be being explored in the discussions about the NCS now.
Thank you. Carol.
I wonder whether one of the panel members from one of the health boards might contribute a wee bit to the discussion.
One of the from the other IGBs.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, no one is asked to come in, but if there's anyone specifically, maybe if you go to Stephen.
Yeah, thanks. And I would agree entirely with what Judith's already outlined. I think at this, in the lead up to every financial settlement and into the new financial year, there are always inevitably tensions, and those tensions are heightened, as you can well imagine, with the pressures on council budgets and the NHS budgets, and therefore resultantly the IJBs, and recognising that. Certainly in my experience of two IJBs as chief officer and working in two different areas, the key element of all of this is about relationships. It's as Judith's outlined, that making sure that we regularly meet with finance colleagues across the piece, including the chief finance officer for the IJB, but also council and NHS, making sure that where there are tensions and where people's priorities are maybe not always aligned, that's where the importance of council plans, community planning partnership plans, clinical strategies, strategic plans of the IJB, that all of the work that goes into creating those at a local level and making sure they are as aligned as they can be helps make decisions around budgets and priorities, etc. But there is no doubt that, as Feely had outlined, I recognise I've been fortunate maybe in terms of my own experience, but I recognise that can get very tense for some colleagues across the country, and there's no doubt that one way of sorting that would be that rather than relying on the contributions of the delegated services from the councils and respective NHS boards, that the NCS at a local level would be directly funded in a way that would eradicate some of those tensions and discussions that inevitably take place every year.
Just to ask one last thing, is there any particular area that causes the most tension, would you say, or is it just dependent on what you're discussing at the time?
I think it can be various things, but as you can imagine, when councils, for example, are looking across the piece at where their opportunities are for managing within the financial envelope they have, they're making decisions across not only health and social care priorities, but you know, development and infrastructure and economic development and housing and education, and all of those things are in the mix, and the council may well have a different view, for example, about where some of those priorities may lie than the NHS board or the IJB, and it's trying to navigate our way through those challenges around what the resultant and expected savings may be in terms of the settlement that comes from council. And NHS is likewise in terms of how they prioritise and relation to the settlements. The past couple of years, most of the settlements have been fairly straightforward in relation to clear pass through from councils and NHS. When they receive their settlements, there's been clear direction, which has alleviated some of the challenge in the system. But ongoing, would that be a sustainable approach? Probably not. I don't know if that helps answer the question. Just
we've actually gone over time, but I'm conscious of the fact that Alan and Vicky would like to come in. If I can ask you to be brief, please. It's been a very busy morning and we've still got quite a lot of on our agenda in private session. If I can come to Alan first of all.
Thanks, convener. Very, very briefly, yeah, part of the frustration, I guess, for our response to National Care Service is we in Inverclyde were very fortunate to NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and Inverclyde Council as two very supportive partners. Even when things have been tight for many years now, the council continue to invest in services for us. We have a new learning disability hub at £7.4 million that was signed off last year. So it's just, I think sometimes it feels as if we're trying to sort something that isn't necessarily broken. And I think we're fortunate in Clyde we've had that two partners who are very sympathetic, who work with us and have a history of working with us to invest in services, but we do appreciate it may be a bit more challenging in other areas, but it's a sense of frustration because there's so much good work going on in Inverclyde across the partnership around finances, which are potentially very difficult. So it's just to give you a perspective that, you know, there are good things happening, good conversations between the appropriate officers, chief financial officers, chief social work officers, and we shouldn't really be forgetting that as we're thinking about how can we move forward and make things better across the piece.
Thank you very much, Alan. And I can come to Vicky finally.
Yeah, again, briefly, and it's just something which I guess has been noted throughout the Derek Feely report as well, in terms of the original intent which underpinned the integration legislation was that the resources would lose their identity, that we would be able to deploy a completely integrated financial resource in line with our strategic plans. And I think largely that hasn't happened throughout the progress of the development of the integration authorities. And the main reason for that is because the resources that are delegated to us really come in the form of our workforce. That makes up the major component of our financial resource, because of course we don't have delegated responsibility for capital assets or other financial issues. And with that comes a lot of restriction. And so if there's anything that we need to learn from that rolling into new arrangements, it's to try and establish a new authority or a new health and social care board that has the full capacity to distribute the financial resources and to influence, if you like, the human resources that form part of that organisation in an equal way. And again, we do have a reservation that there's a suggestion that the new boards will have employing rights and controls over part of the workforce and not another part of the workforce. With it comes quite a lot of restriction when it comes to managing the financial resource and strategic planning.
To thank our four panel members for the time this morning. Our next meeting in the committee will begin its scrutiny of the National Care Service Scotland Bill, but that does conclude the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.